This is unquestionably true with regard to posterity. The great man of former times are handed down to us free from the ephemeral accusations of their contemporaries. But it is not thus. During the lifetime of the individual, and in 1814, Napoleon was convinced by cruel spirits that even deeds may vanish before the fury of declamation. At the moment of his fall, he was absolutely overwhelmed by a torrent of abuse. But it was reserved for him whose life had been so fertile in prodigious prodigies to surmount this adverse stroke of fate and almost immediately to arise resplendent from amidst his own ruins. His miraculous return is certainly unparalleled both in its execution and its results. The transports which it called forth penetrated into neighboring countries where prayers for his success were offered up either publicly or in secret. And he who in 1814 was defeated and pursued as a scourge of human nature suddenly reappeared in 1815 as the hope of his fellow creatures. Calumny and falsehood in this instance lost their prey by having overshot their mark. The good sense of mankind, in a great measure, rendered justice to Napoleon, and the abuse that has been heaped upon him would not be believed now. Poison lost its effect on Mithridates, said the emperor, as he was the other day glancing over some new libels upon himself, and since 1814, calumny cannot injure me. In the universal clamor which was directed against him when, in the enjoyment of his power, England bore the most conspicuous part. In England, two great machines were maintained in full activity, the one conducted by the emigrants, for whom nothing was too bad, and the other under the control of the English ministers, who had established a system of defamation, and who had regularly organized its action and effects. They maintained in their pay pamphleteers and libelists in every corner of Europe. Their tasks were marked out to them, and their plan of attack were regularly laid and combined. The English ministry multiplied the employment of these potent engines in England more than elsewhere. The English, who were more free and enlightened than other nations, stood the more in need of excitement. From this system of English ministers derived the twofold advantage of rousing public opinion against the common enemy and withdrawing attention from their own conduct by directing popular clamor and indignation to the character and conduct of others. By this means, their own character and conduct were screened from that investigation and recrimination which they might not have found very agreeable. Thus, the assassination of Paul at St. Petersburg and of our envoys in Persia, the seizure of Napertandi in the free city of Hamburg, the capture in the time of peace of two rich Spanish frigates, the acquisition of the whole of India, the retaining of Malta, and the Cape of Good Hope against the faith of treaties, the Machiavellian rupture of the Treaty of Amiens, the unjust seizure of our ships, previously to a new declaration of war, the Danish fleet seized with such cold and ironical perfidy, etc., etc. All these aggressions were overlooked in the general agitation which had been artfully stirred up against a foreign power. In order to take a just view of the accusations which have been heaped upon Napoleon by the numerous publications written against him, it is necessary to make allowance for passions and circumstances, to reject with contempt all that is apocryphal, anonymous, and purely declamatory, and to adhere solely to the facts and proofs which would doubtless have been produced by those who, after the overthrow of their enemies, became possessed of the authentic documents, the archives of the public departments and courts of law, in short, of all the sources of truth, which are usually to be found in society, but nothing has been published, nothing has been brought forward, and therefore how much of this monstrous scaffolding falls to the ground. And to be still more rigidly equitable, if we wish to judge Napoleon by the example of his peers, or great men in analogous circumstances, that is to say, by comparing him with the founders of dynasties, or those who have ascended thrones, By dint of popular commotions, it may then confidently be said that he is unequaled, and that he shines purely from amidst all that is opposed to him. It would be a loss of time to cite the numberless examples furnished by ancient and modern history. They are accessible to everyone. It is only necessary to refer to the two countries which are here under consideration. Did Napoleon, like Hugh Capet, fight against the sovereign? Did he cause him to perish in captivity? Did Napoleon act like the princes of the present House of Brunswick, who in 1715 and 1745 crowded the scaffold with victims, victims to whom the present English ministers, though their inconsequential policy and the principles they now profess, leave no other title than that of faithful subjects dying for their lawful sovereign? The course by which Napoleon advanced to supreme power is perfectly simple and natural. It is single in history. The very circumstance of his elevation render it unparalleled. I did not usurp the crown, said he one day to the Council of State. I took it up out of the mire. The people placed it on my head. Let their acts be respected. And by thus taking up the crown, Napoleon restored France to her rank in European society, terminated her horrors, and revived her character. He freed us of all the evils of our fatal crisis and reserved to us all the advantages arising out of it. I ascended the throne unsullied by any of the crimes of my situation, said he on one occasion. How few founders of dynasties can say as much? Never. During any period of our history were favors distributed with so much impartiality. Never was merit so indiscriminately sought out and rewarded, public money so usefully employed, the arts and sciences better encouraged, or the glory and luster of the country raised to so high a pitch. It is my wish, said he one day to the Council of State, that the title of Frenchman should be the best and most desirable on earth. That a Frenchman traveling through any part of Europe may think and find himself at home. If liberty seemed occasionally to suffer encroachments, if authority seemed sometimes to overstep its limits, circumstances rendered those measures necessary and inevitable. Our present misfortunes have, though too late, made us sensible of this truth. We now render justice, though also too late, to the courage, judgment, and foresight which then dictated those steps. It is certain that in this respect, the political fall of Napoleon has considerably increased his influence. Who can now doubt that his glory and the luster of his character have been infinitely augmented by his misfortunes? If the works which have fallen in my way should present any circumstances connected with these general considerations, they will be the object of my particular attention. I do not intend to enter upon a political controversy. I shall not address myself to party men whose opinions are founded on their interests and passions. I speak only to the cool friend of truth, or to the unprejudiced writer who in future times may impartially seek for materials. To them alone I address myself. In their eyes my testimony will be superior to anonymous evidence and will rank with that which bears a credible character. The first work that I looked into was the Anti-Gallican, of which I shall speak hereafter. The 19th through the 22nd, we continued our course with the same wind, the same day, and the same temperature. Our voyage was monotonous, but pleasant. Our days were long, but employment helped them to glide away. The emperor now began regularly to dictate to me his campaigns of Italy. I had already written several chapters for the first few days. The emperor viewed this occupation with indifference, but the regularity and promptitude with which I presented to him my daily task, together with the progress we made, soon excited his interest, and at length the pleasure he derived from this dictation rendered it absolutely necessary to him. He was sure to send for me about 11 o'clock every morning, and he seemed himself to await the hour with impatience. I always read to him what he had dictated on the preceding day, and he then made corrections and dictated farther. In this way the time passed rapidly till 4 o'clock arrived, when he summoned his valet de chambre. He then proceeded to the state cabin and passed the time until dinner in playing at piquet or chess. The emperor dictates very rapidly, almost as fast as he speaks in ordinary conversation. I was therefore obliged to invent a kind of hieroglyphic writing, and I, in my turn, dictated to my son. I was happy enough to be able to collect almost literally every sentence that fell from him. I had now not a moment to spare at dinner time. Somebody was sure to come and tell me that all the company were seated at table. Fortunately, my seat was near the door, which always stood open. I had some time since changed my place at the request of Captain Ross, the commander of the vessel, who, as he did not speak French, took the opportunity of occasionally asking me the meaning of words. I therefore took my seat between him and the Grand Marshal. Captain Ross was a man of agreeable manners and was exceedingly kind and attentive to us. I had learned, according to the English custom, to invite him to take a glass of wine, drinking mine to the health of his wife, and he would then drink to the health of mine. This was our daily practice. After dinner, the emperor never failed to allude to his morning dictation, as if pleased with the occupation and amusement it afforded him. On these occasions, as well as whenever I happened to meet him in the course of the day, he would address me in a jocular tone with, "Ah, sage Lascasis, illustrious memorialist, Decelius St. Helena," and other similar expressions. Then he would frequently add, "My dear Lascasis, these memoirs will be as celebrated as any that have preceded them. You will survive as long as any previous memoir writer. It will be impossible to dwell upon the great events of our time or to write about me without referring to you." Then, resuming his pleasantry, he would add, "After all, it will be said, he must have known Napoleon well. He was his counselor of state, his chamberlain, his faithful companion. We cannot help believing him, for he was an honest man and incapable of misrepresentation." The 23rd through the 25th, the west wind still continued, to our great astonishment. It was a sort of phenomenon in these regions and had hitherto been very much in our favor. But with regard to phenomena, chance produced one of a much more extraordinary kind on the 23rd, when we crossed the line in zero longitude and zero declination. This is a circumstance which chance alone may perhaps renew only once in a century, since it is necessary to arrive precisely at the first meridian about noon in order to pass the line at that same hour and to arrive there at the same time with the sun. This was a day of great merriment and disorder among the crew. It was a ceremony which our sailors called the christening, and which the English call the great shaving day. The sailors dress themselves up in the most grotesque way. One is disguised as Neptune, and all persons on board the ship who have not previously crossed the line are formally presented to him. An immense razor is passed over their chins with a lather made of pitch. Buckets of water are thrown over them, and the loud bursts of laughter which accompany their retreat complete their initiation into the grand mystery. No one is spared, and the officers are generally more roughly used than the lowest of the sailors, the admiral, who had previously amused himself by endeavoring to alarm us with the anticipation of this awful ceremony, now very courteously exempted us from the inconvenience and ridicule attending it. We were with every mark of attention and respect presented to the rude god, who paid to each of us a compliment after his own fashion, and thus our trial ended. The emperor was scrupulously respected during the whole of this Saturnalian festivity, when respect is usually shown to no one. On being informed of the decorum which had been observed with respect to him, he ordered 100 Napoleons to be distributed to the grotesque Neptune and his crew, which the admiral opposed, perhaps from motives of prudence as well as politeness. The 26th through the 30th, the weather still continued favorable. Having passed the line, we momentarily expected to fall in with an east or southeast wind. The continuance of the west wind was extraordinary, and it was impossible it could last much longer. The resolution which the admiral had adopted of bearing considerably to the east rendered our situation very favorable. and we had every reason to hope for a short passage. One afternoon, the sailors caught an enormous shark. The emperor inquired the cause of the great noise and confusion, which he suddenly heard overheard. Being informed of what had occurred, he expressed a wish to have a sight of the sea monster. He accordingly went up to the poop and incautiously approached too near the animal, which by a sudden movement knocked down four or five of the sailors and had well nigh broken the emperor's legs. He went below with his left stocking covered in blood. We thought he was severely hurt, but it proved to be only the blood of the shark. My labors advanced with the greatest regularity. The Antigallican, which was the first work I undertook to read, was a volume of 500 pages comprising all that had been written in England at the time when that country was menaced with the French invasion. It was the object of the English government to nationalize opposition to that attempt and arouse the whole nation against her dangerous enemy. The book contained a collection of public speeches, exhortations, patriotic appeals of zealous citizens, satirical songs, sarcastic productions, and highly colored newspaper articles, all pouring a torrent of odium and ridicule upon the French and their first consul, whose courage, genius, and power excited the greatest alarm. This was all perfectly natural and allowable. Productions of this sort are like a shower of arrows thrown by combatants before they come to a close action. Some hit and some are carried away by the wind. Such writings will never afford satisfactory evidence to a man of judgment, and they scarcely merit contradiction. Pamphleteers are little regarded because their character is the antidote of their poison. It is not so with the historian. The latter, however, degrades himself to a level with the pamphlet writer when he departs from the calm dignity and impartiality required for his office to indulge in declamations and to steep his pen in gall. With these feelings, I arose from the perusal of the different productions of Sir Robert Wilson, which I read after the Antigallican. This writer did us the greater injury because his talents, his courage, and his numerous and brilliant services gave him importance in the eyes of his countrymen. A circumstance which I am about to state caused the writings of Sir R. Wilson to be particularly known and spoken of on board the ship. Sir Robert had a son amongst the young midshipmen on board the Northumberland, and my son, whose similarity of age occasioned him to be much in the society of these youths, could easily observe the change which took place in their opinions with respect to us. They were at first very much prejudiced against us. When the emperor came on board, they regarded him as an ogre ready to devour them. But on a better acquaintance with us, truth soon exercised over them the same influence which it produced on the rest of the crew. This was, however, at the expense of young Wilson, who was scouted by his companions by way of expiation, as they said, for the stories which his father had circulated. At this part of the manuscript, a great number of leaves are struck out. The reason was explained on the margin as follows. I had collected numerous offensive statements from the writings of Sir Robert Wilson, to which I had perhaps replied with too much bitterness. A recent circumstance has induced me to suppress this portion of my journal. Sir Robert Wilson has lately acted a conspicuous part in a cause which does honor to the hearts of all who were concerned in it. I allude to the saving of Lavalette. Being asked before a French tribunal whether he had not formerly published works respecting our affairs, he replied in the affirmative and added that he had stated in them what he then believed to be true. These words are more to the purpose than anything I could say, and I therefore hasten to cancel what I have already written, happy in thus having an opportunity to render justice to Sir Robert Wilson, on whose sincerity and good intentions I had in my indignation cast reflections. I therefore set aside the works of Sir Robert Wilson and the various accusations contained in them. I also suppressed the numerous refutations I had collected. I shall merely stop to consider one circumstance which has been repeated in 100 different works, the report of which has been circulated through Europe and has obtained credit even in France. I allude to the poisoning of the men infected with the plague at Jaffa. Certainly, nothing can more clearly prove how easy calumny may affect its object. If the voice of slander be bold and powerful and can command numerous echoes, no matter how far probability, reasons, common sense, and truth be violated, the wished for end is sure to be attained. A general, a hero, a great man, hitherto respected by fortune, as well as by mankind, at that moment riveting the attention of three quarters of the globe, commanding admiration even from his enemies, was suddenly accused of a crime declared to be unheard of and unparalleled, an act pronounced to be inhuman, atrocious, and cruel, and what is above all extraordinary, he could have no possible object in committing that crime. The most absurd details, the most improbable circumstances, the most ridiculous episodes were invented to give a coloring to this first falsehood. The story was circulated through Europe. Malevolence seized it, exaggerated its enormity. It was published in every newspaper, recorded in every book, and thenceforward was looked upon as an established fact. Indignation was at its height and clamor universal. It would have been vain to reason or to attempt to stem the torrent or to show that no proof of the fact had been adduced and that the story contradicted itself. It would have been vain to bring forward opposite and incontrovertible evidence, the evidence of those very medical men who were said to have administered or to have refused to administer the poison. It would have been vain to expose the unreasonableness of accusing of inhumanity the man who, but a short time before, had immortalized the hospitals of Jaffa by an act of the sublimest heroism, risking his own safety by solemnly touching the troops infected with the plague to deceive and soothe the imaginations of the sick men. In vain might it have been urged that the idea of such a crime could not be affixed to him, who, when consulted by the medical officers as to the expediency of burning or merely washing the clothes worn by the invalids and being reminded of the enormous loss attendant on the former measure, replied, "Gentlemen, I came here to fix the attention and to recall the interests of Europe to the center of the ancient world and not with the view of amassing wealth. In vain would it have been shown that there could be no object, no motive whatever for this supposed crime. Had the French general any reason to suspect a design for corrupting his invalids and converting them into reinforcements against himself? Did he hope that this barbarous act would completely rid him of the infection? He might have effected that object equally well by leaving his invalids to be overtaken by the enemy's troops, which would moreover have been the means of spreading the contagion among the latter. It would have been vain to show that an unfeeling and selfish chief might have freed himself from all embarrassment by merely leaving the unfortunate men behind him. They would have been massacred, it is true, but no one would ever have thought of addressing a reproach to him. These and all other arguments would have been vain and useless, so powerful and infallible are the effects of falsehood and declamation when the passions of mankind are interested in their propagation. The imaginary crime was repeated by every mouth, was engraven on every heart, and to the common mass of mankind, it will, perhaps, forever continue to be a positive, incontrovertible fact, a circumstance which will not a little surprise those who have yet to learn how little credit is to be due to public report, and which will also serve to show the errors that may creep into history, is that Marshal Bertrand, who was himself with the army in Egypt, though certainly in a rank which did not enable him to come into immediate contact with the general-in-chief, firmly believed up to the period of his residence in St. Helena the story of poison having been administered to 60 invalids. The report was circulated and believed even in our army, therefore. What answer could be given to those who triumphantly asserted? It is a fact, I assure you, I have it from officers who served in the French army at the time. Nevertheless, the whole story is false. I have collected the following facts from the highest source, from the mouth of Napoleon himself. First, that the invalids in question who were infected with the plague amounted, according to the report made to the general-in-chief, only to 7 in number. Second, that it was not the general-in-chief, but a professional man who at the time of the crisis proposed the administering of opium. Third, that opium was not administered to a single individual. Fourth, that the retreat having been effected slowly, a rear guard was left behind in Jaffa for 3 days. Fifth, that on the departure of the rear guard, the invalids were all dead, except one or two who must have fallen into the hands of the English. N.B. Since my return to Paris, having had opportunities of conversing with those whose situation and profession naturally rendered them the first actors in this scene, those whose testimony must be considered as official and authentic, I have had the curiosity to inquire into the most minute details. And the following is the result of my inquiries. The invalids under the care of the surgeon in chief, that is to say the wounded, were all, without exception, removed with the help of the horses belonging to the staff, not excepting even those of the general in chief, who proceeded for considerable distance on foot like the rest of the army. These, therefore, are quite out of the question. With regard to the rest of the invalids, about 20 in number, they were under the care of the physician in chief and who were in absolutely desperate condition, totally unfit to be removed while the enemy was advancing. It is very true that Napoleon asked the physician in chief whether it would not be an act of humanity to administer opium to them. It is also true that the physician replied his business was to cure, not to kill, an answer which, as it seems to have reference to an order rather than to a subject of discussion, has perhaps furnished a basis on which slander and falsehood might invent and propagate the fabrication which has since been circulated on this subject. Finally, the details which I have been able to collect afford me the following incontestable results. First, that no order was given for the administering of opium to the sick. Second, that there was not at the period in question in the medicine chest of the army a single grain of opium for the use of the sick. Third, that even had the order been given, and had there been a supply of opium, temporary and local circumstances, which it would be tedious to enumerate here, would have rendered its execution impossible.